So welcome everybody to the third annual Hush Harbor.
Of the United States appearing on its great seal. An idealistic thought, but one that is flawed in reality. It has always been a tool of the oppressor to divide us. Even they knew the power we would have if we as a people were united in spirit, deed, and body. Dividing us into silos among the diaspora would instigate jealousy and create a way to control the sable-skinned masses of Africans sold into slavery. But Africa is what unites us and flows through us. Whether you were sold from the Ghanaian Gold Coast, the Nigeria Kingdom of Benin, or the island of Sierra Leone, the spirit of that land can never be purged from our blood. Now, not out of many one, out of one many.
The Atlantic slave trade stole over 12 million Africans from the continent to America in exchange for raw materials. English, Spanish, and Portuguese traders visited the coast of Africa, establishing castles and trade posts to house and ship natives. Once captured, they were holding on to slavers packed tight like sardines in head-to-toe fashion. The more they could carry, the higher the profit margin for European trade.
The enslaved were made to live below deck in indescribable horror. Depending on the weather, this voyage across the Atlantic, notoriously dubbed the Middle Passage, took 1 to 6 months. Disease and starvation led to high mortality rates. Dead bodies were thrown overboard in the numbers high enough to change the migration tendencies of sharks that followed these slavers for the steady meal.
The first stop on this voyage would, for some, be their last, the Caribbean. Here is where traders made their first sales. Slaves were placed in camps to prepare them for seasoning. You might recall how Big Ma used to season her cast iron pots for use. It involved greasing the pan and placing it in extreme heat to make it durable. This same method was applied to our ancestors. They were greased with palm oil to disguise any bruises or injuries they may have acquired on the passage. In these seasoning camps, Africans were starved and beaten into submission. Once a soul had reached the desired level of acquiescence, they were branded with a symbol representing their seasoning complete. Slave traders and owners believed They believed that if a person survived this critical period of seasoning, they were less likely to die, and the psychological element would make them more easily controlled. Those who survived this process became seasoned and typically commanded a higher price in the market. They were then placed in the extreme Caribbean heat to learn how to plant and harvest sugar. Jamaica, Barbados, Cuba, or Brazil, no matter the destination, seasoning took place in earnest. Death rates during seasoning were estimated to be as high as 50%. On the island of Jamaica, where the most notorious seasoning camp was located, the mortality rate reached as high as 33%.
The seasoning of slaves tried its best to eradicate all African remnants, dividing us by tribe, disrupting our languages, and destroying our families, beating us into submission and changing our names. Their attempts would be devastating to the African peoples. Dispersed throughout the island nations and the Americas, Africans would have to make a concerted effort to recognize their history. It would be so much easier just to acquiesce and take on the citizenship of the oppressor as if it would make us one of them.
Tonight, we are reminded that we are of one blood. We will hear from three people involved in the transatlantic slave economy. A wife, a daughter, a trader. all three links in the chain of the exchange, each with a unique perspective.
Why didn't I listen? Why? If I could only turn back the hands of time. Why didn't I listen to my mother's directives? She told me never to trust a white man. It was in the Christian castle that I met him. We were married by the sacerdote, the castle priest, and he was the one that baptized me into this Christian faith. I denounced all the gods of my youth for him. But what? We all thought it was such an honor to work for the Portuguese. I mean, only the most beautiful and the most intelligent of us were chosen. And I was honored to be chosen as one of those women. And I remember I worked hard in the castle. And then that day, I saw him. He was giving a tour of the castle to some children. And when he saw me, it was like an instant connection. And he told me he loved the way that I spoke his native tongue. I mean, many of us could speak Portuguese, but he said it was the way that I spoke and the twinkle that was in my eyes when I spoke. And he was just so respectful. He was so kind. He even went to my mother and asked permission to take my hand in marriage. It was such wonderful times. He even had everybody that worked under him respect me and treat me with honor. I blessed him with three beautiful children, three handsome boys, and the years were good. But I never would have thought that that day so many years ago when he and my sons got on that boat, that it would be the last time that I saw them. Yes, they wrote to me and they told me that they were having a wonderful time there. My husband said that he was going to send for me. And I was looking forward to that day and I prepared. And then the last letter I got from him told me the boat was coming and I shouldn't worry about my belongings. There'd be space on the boat. I'd have my own cabin and I'd put all my stuff into that cabin. But when the ship came, it was a slaver. And I felt uneasy. And then my whole life changed again because the captain of the ship made it very clear to me that he would not be serving me, but I would be serving him. And then he showed me the papers. He slipped me. I have been purchased from wife to slave. What about my mother? What about my boys? He told me I wasn't going to Brazil to meet my family. I was going to live in Cuba on a plantation. Cuba? What is Cuba? The place even sounds evil. What about my children? What about my sons?
Sanaya, I was so worried. Are you okay?
I'm fine. I'm okay.
Where have you been? It's been 2 days. I've been waiting for you. When the Englishmen came, I thought it would be to purchase us both. I never thought they would take only you. Did they say where we are?
We're in a place called Jamaica. The white men were very excited that I understood the language.
But you do not speak English. What do they mean?
Their friend is Auntie.
Did you get to meet her? Do you think they will be kind to you? You have to be very careful with these people, Sanaya.
I do not know, but I hope so.
Oh, my child, I had so hoped that when I taught you that language, when I taught you Spanish, it would be to help you. I knew from our interaction with the Europeans, learning the language would be essential. I never thought it would lead to our separation.
You know where if someone will purchase you, we will not be far from each other.
Oh, my darling. When you were gone, the guard came and told us that those not sold would move on to a place in America, a place called Charleston in South Carolina.
No, Auntie, I will not leave you.
You have no choice. You can either fight and die or go and live the best of your life. You're old enough now to know the ways of the the white man, Sanaya. Do not trust their words, because we have seen their deeds.
Yes, Auntie.
Remember who you are, Sanaya. You are Sanaya Nayama, daughter, great-granddaughter of Nana Okentan. Never forget where you come from.
Yes, Auntie.
You are Sanaya Nayama, daughter of Antia Oti. Never forget who you come from.
Yes, Auntie.
You are Sanaya Nayama of the Oyoko clan. Never forget your power.
Yes, Auntie.
You are Sanaya Nayama of the Ashanti people. We are a fierce tribe who fought against British domination. Your father, he did not cower when faced against guns and weapons of the British. No, your mother, my sister, she had 3 fields of palm, which increased her wealth tenfold, and it would have been yours if not for civil war. Sanaya, our blood of the Ashanti people bleeds within us. Never forget.
Yes, Auntie.
Sanaya, never forget. This sea that may separate us, it will never come between us. Our hearts bleed the blood of the Ashanti. Sanaya, never forget, because I will never forget you.
I love you, I will never forget.
I was born in Galicia, Spain, to peasant parents, but that would all soon change. By happenstance, I found myself on a ship bound for Sierra Leone, where I was privileged to apprentice with this trader. It was here that I learned how my family could finally be free from the weight of poverty. Ah, yes, the lucrative slave trade. Off the coast of Sierra Leone is located Lomboko. It is here that I fell in love with my first queen. Her name, Siakana. She was the daughter of the local ruler, and she was beautiful. Not the typical beauty of the women of Spain. See her skin? It was bright as if the sun was shining and glistening off of it. Her smile could brighten the darkest corners of any room, for that is where she found me. But that's information for another day. To make a long story short, I'm in on my wife, as you can tell. I just never got permission from the king. So what did I do in order to escape this anger? I traded with the king some captives off of our ship, the conquistador. I left her and my first son in her father's home with enough treasures to fill a castle. So don't worry, don't trip. They were good. They were good. I took care of them. I took care of them. But I was a slave trader. I had to go different places and do different things and take care of different people, you know. You see, I have many companies stationed in Brazil and Texas and, of course, Cuba. Ah, yes, my sweet Cuba. This is where I have many a gold mine in Cuba. You see, in Cuba, I had to diversify. I not only dealt in the slave trade, but my meal supplies supplied half of Spain with sugar. And what motor empowered those sugar mills? Oh, duh, Africans. What else? Who else? It was the slave trade. That was their business to make me rich. Can't you tell by my iPhone? The key to success with the African is to turn them against each other. Go inland, make nice, choose a wife. Choose 2 even, why not 3? Have many children with her and with him, and there you will find your free labor. It'll create what we call the Creole, a buffer class. 2 black to be white, and 2 white to be black. They will be thankful that they did not live like the slave. Divide and elevate them, and they will serve you willingly. God forbid they catch on to this plot. They outnumber us 3-1. And we will be destroyed if they consolidated their power. I have made it my life this way. At every major port, I have installed my Creole family, my free labor, all of African blood, my slaves. But it is as if they did not know. They fight like children over those who appear to be most European. I find it adorable though. These young ones think that they want to be white. But they can't. They just don't have it anymore. They will never reach the top. No matter the shade, black will always be black, which suits me just fine.